morning, buenos dias, bienvenidos, welcome to our Madrid campus, to the IESE Madrid campus here this morning. Welcome to a highly anticipated session with the Nobel Prize winning economist Joseph Stiglitz, the former president of the European Commission, João Durão Barroso. Thank you for making your way here to our campus in the outskirts of Madrid. Let me thank, in the first place, Rafael Villaseca and the Fundación Naturgy for their support of the Energy Prospectives. Also, thank you to Naturgy, Paco Rines, who's always been very supportive of these talks here. Thank you for this collaboration, which has been going on now for a good number of years. When we started, only a few foresighted people realized how important the energy sector and different questions around energy were going to be. This has been a good number of years ago. Rafael was one of those people who realized that the energy sector was going to change, profoundly change, and it would have many implications at the economic, political, and other levels. And it was worthwhile spending time discussing with experts in different areas about the implications and learning together. For an academic institution like IESE, this is exactly the kind of activity that we like, that's up our avenue, the combination of profound insights based on academic research together with the applicability in entrepreneurial and business settings. That's exactly the kind of work that we also like to do, so that's why we're always happy to have these sessions together that with the foundation IESE is hosting. I want to thank, of course, also our main speakers, Joseph Stiglitz, for coming over all the way. I heard you have a refuge in the north of Spain, so it wasn't that far, but still, thank you for coming. João Barroso also for joining us here today, and of course, I also want to thank Jordi Gual for the moderation that he's going to be doing. And from this place also, we are here today on June 19th. It's a special day. It's actually the 10th anniversary of the enthronement of King Felipe VI. That's why Madrid also is in a festive mood. And if you cross Madrid, in many ways, too, also. So from here also, congratulations and thank you to King Felipe VI for his service to Spain. Thank you for being here with us, and let me hand over to our co-host here, Rafael Villaseca. Thank you.
Many thanks, Raf. Many thanks. Muy buenos días a todos. Es una satisfacción tener la posibilidad de presentar la jornada número 16 de nuestro Energy Prospective, actividad que comenzó hace ya 5 años y que hacemos con la colaboración del IESE, aunque una vez más, a los que una vez más quiero agradecer su apoyo y su interés por mantener estas jornadas. Jornadas que, a la vista de la atención de todos ustedes, creo que modestamente calificamos y estamos muy contentos con ella como un éxito. La verdad es que cuando lanzamos eso hace ya 5 años, lo hacíamos enmarcando esta actividad dentro de lo que nuestra fundación pretende hacer. Básicamente 2 cosas, que aunque las conozcan, déjenme que las repita muy brevemente. Más o menos la mitad de nuestra actividad, de nuestros recursos, van dedicados a funciones sociales, actividades sociales que quizá ustedes conozcan. Rehabilitación energética de viviendas, colaboración en formación profesional, ayuda a las familias vulnerables, siempre naturalmente dentro del ámbito de la energía, que es el que nos dirige y el que nos apoya nuestro patrono principal, el grupo Naturgy. Pero un segundo vector de actividad es tratar de ilustrar a todas las personas interesadas en el sector de la energía con datos y opiniones. Modestamente queremos colaborar a ello porque pensamos que son objetivos realmente importantes. Ciertamente, el sector de la energía no faltan datos, quizá en ocasiones hasta sobran, pero sí que era nuestra opinión de que faltaba estructurarlos, darles la importancia que algunos tienen frente a otros, ordenarlos, hacerlos en series históricas que permitan analizarlos y, sobre todo, aportarlos de una manera ordenada y sistemática por personalidades que tuvieran la capacidad de sentar opiniones ciertas sobre esos datos. Esto era una, y ustedes lo conocerán quizá a base de las muchas publicaciones que vamos haciendo con una cierta regularidad. El otro, sin duda, era tratar de dar opinión, no naturalmente de los que estamos en la fundación, que tengo la satisfacción de presidir, sino de personalidades del sector, personalidades de la vida económica, política y social, que han trabajado y conocen el sector de la energía y, por lo tanto, podían dar unas opiniones sobre las que, con la ayuda de los datos, los actores del sector, públicos o privados, pudieran tomar mejores decisiones. Era este nuestro objetivo y, ciertamente, hemos trabajado, espero que con éxito, en intentar aportar nuestro granito de arena. Y en esto se basó la idea del Energy Prospective. Con la ayuda del IESE, la idea era cada trimestre, descontando el de verano, tener la posibilidad de tener dos speakers de altura internacional capaces de darnos opiniones importantes sobre cuál era el futuro inmediato de la energía en relación con una determinada área. Nos parecía importante, no vale la pena perder mucho tiempo indicando la enorme relevancia de la energía dentro de múltiples actividades de nuestra sociedad. ¿Qué decir? La energía y el desarrollo, la energía y la tecnología, la energía y la geoestrategia, la energía y la economía, evidentemente han estado históricamente, no es novedad, lo está otra vez ahora y de una manera muy potente, pero históricamente lo han sido, han estado muy ligados y han explicado muchos de los fenómenos sociales, económicos y políticos que hemos vivido. Por eso nos pareció importante poder traer personalidades que nos ilustraran sobre eso. Hoy en día tenemos para hoy programada una sesión sobre el tema política y energía. Resulta de lo más oportuno hacerlo, porque no hay duda de que sobre los clásicos debates que tenía este sector, quizá ya por siglos, viene uno que realmente se nos impone con toda su gravedad e importancia: el cambio climático, la transición energética. No hay ninguna duda de que esto sobrepone a los importantes problemas, retos del sector, uno de enorme trascendencia. Y, indudablemente, la política ha tenido y va a tener mucho que decir sobre cómo enfocar esa transición energética de forma y de manera que el clásico trilema que todos ustedes conocen sobre el sector de la energía pueda desarrollarse sin que ninguna de sus tres patas resulte perjudicada. Y es que realmente no sobran datos y opiniones relevantes para enfocar este tremendo problema al que nos enfrentamos, si no tenemos en cuenta no solo la situación en donde estamos y dónde queremos ir, sino cómo lo vamos a hacer. En definitiva, qué políticas vamos a aplicar para conseguir los objetivos que nos proponemos. Tengo para mí, y me disculparán que de mi opinión, que en ocasiones el no tomar en consideración todos los datos sobre los que tenemos que partir y además opiniones relevantes sobre los que realmente han trabajado en áreas nos lleva en ocasiones a decisiones que no son las óptimas o que no tienen todas las consideraciones respecto a los efectos secundarios que en ocasiones esas decisiones políticas, económicas y sociales imponen. Es por eso que, modestamente, pero de la manera más eficaz que podamos, nos gusta aportar datos y opiniones que puedan ilustrarles a todos mejor los que están interesados en esta cuestión tan trascendente para el mundo en el que vivimos. Today we have two world-class speakers of exceptional stature. First, we have José Manuel Durão Barroso. He is currently chairman of Goldman Sachs International and was president of the European Commission between 2004 and 2014, after 2 years as prime minister of Portugal. During his tenure at the European Commission, he pushed for considerable enlargement on its member states and launched the first ambitious programs related to energy transition, embodied in the 2020 targets. His experience in seeking broad agreements between nations of different characteristics in the EU environment is of enormous value at a time like the present, where we are facing global challenges of a global nature that require enormous collaboration between all the parties concerned, not least the energy transition. It will be great interest to hear his views on the policy to be developed by the next European Commission. We also have Professor Jaffa Stiglitz, one of the world's leading economists and winner of the 2001 Nobel Prize in Economics. He's professor at Columbia University and chief economist of the Roosevelt Institute. He has made major contributions to understanding the effects of globalization on international trade and the impact of government intervention in the economic publishing numerous articles, studies and books on the subject. It will be very interesting to hear his views on the challenge of climate change, its impacts on the US economy, and possible predictions in view of the upcoming presidential elections. At a time of great uncertainty in the political direction of the US and the European Union, his vision of how this may affect our economies, the energy transition process, and its relationship with the rest of the world is of extraordinary interest. Both will give us their view on the uncertainties we face, followed by a debate that will be moderated by Professor Jordi Wall, Professor of Economics at IESE, who will undoubtedly contribute to his expert vision to an even more interesting debate. Well, that's all for my part. Many thanks for your presence here. And gentlemen, the floor is yours.
Okay, well, good morning, buenos dias. I think I don't have to go through the introductions because Mr. Villaseca already explained the very high profile of our two guests today. As a word of introduction, my only contribution is going to say that it's going to be that the energy has been critical in the last political cycle, both in the US and in Europe, because of climate change and the transition agenda, and also because of the war in Ukraine, which has imposed turbulence in the energy markets and significant changes in the energy policies of the European Union. The European Union, as you all know, doesn't have a common energy policy. It's not part of the acquis communautaire, but if not de jure, de facto, during the crisis, it has undertaken common goals and common policies and has been able to detach itself from the Russian gas up to a point, because we still buy liquid gas from the Russian market. Now, we have had already in Europe elections. The outcome of these elections, my reading, we'll see what's the opinion of Mr. Durão Barroso, is that on the one hand you have increasing the strength of the right and some non very pro-EU countries in the extreme right. And I wonder what are the consequences of that for future initiatives on common energy policies. And we have had also a decline of green parties and the left. And I wonder what are the consequences of that for transition policies, for net zero policies. The European Union, at the same time, is quite different from the US. It will be very interesting to see the contrast, because in the European Union, we don't have a single political entity, and we have very different energy mixes in different parts of the Union and very different geostrategic interests of the different member states. We don't see the world in the same way in the south of Europe than in the north of Europe, and therefore, getting to a common ground on policies is quite difficult. The political scene in America is also interesting. We still don't have the elections there. They will be in November. So I think that it will be also interesting to hear from Mr. Stiglitz what's the positioning of the two contenders on these issues and how do you see the election coming up. Now, as a way to proceed, we will have first, Professor Stiglitz for about 20-25 minutes, and then Mr. Durão Barroso, and then we will open up for questions. You can, I've been told that you can pose your questions and they will come to my desk, if I had a desk, which I don't, but they will come here. And I will try to moderate them and pose them to the speakers. And if not, I will come up with my own questions. All right? So okay. The floor is yours, Professor Stiglitz.
Well, it's already been said, the big issue about the future of U.S. energy policy has to do with the election coming up in November. And economists are really bad at making economic forecasts, and I won't make a political forecast. I think, you know, quite honestly, it's 50-50. There are betting markets that give Trump a much bigger advantage, but I've never been very confident in markets in general, and betting markets I don't think I have any confidence in, but one should be aware that there is a significant chance, maybe 50-50, that Trump will be back in. So anybody in Europe has to think about that as a reasonable, not reasonable, I mean, as a possibility. It's not a reasonable possibility, but it is something that could reasonably happen. So what I want to do in these few minutes is first talk about the very big differences in the policies that would emerge between Biden and Trump, and then talk about some of the similarities, and then talk a little bit about the global perspective and a little bit of my views, if I have time, about what Europe should do. So in terms of, there are very big differences, and one should really realize that it is a bifurcation in the direction. The most important one is that, divisions are that Trump is a climate skeptic. He is probably even a climate denier. He has made climate part of the culture wars, and in general doesn't believe in science. So that's a really difficult position for Europe to deal with. You know, and I it's difficult for Americans to deal with. He's tried to cut the science budget every year. He just doesn't believe in any notion of truth and normal discussion about how you approach difficult issues like this. Making it even more difficult is that he's getting a lot of money. He made a real pitch to the fossil fuel industry. So you have these cultural wars, wars about science, reinforced by real interest in from the fossil fuel industry, and making it just a little bit even more difficult is a lot of people in the financial sector are supporting Trump because they see the possibility of lower taxes. And they're putting aside all the other problems and saying, you know, we think Trump can manage the economy better. I think it's nonsense. But the fact is that support from the fossil fuel industry and then from the financial sector that doesn't want to be regulated to in their lending to the fossil fuel sector has all meant that there will be a marked change in policy. The changes in policies have to do with a whole set of regulations about not only the energy industry, you know, the electricity, the emissions, the auto industry and the emissions of greenhouse gases, the obvious things, but also in the financial sector. One of the things that has been very big about the head of the Securities and Exchange Commission is regulations concerning disclosure of carbon risk. And these have been, you know, taken 3 years to write the regulations and put them in place. They're just getting into place about climate risk. And U.S. is the only central bank that doesn't really assess climate risk. Most of the other central banks have taken on board that there is a, you know, let me explain the argument. People say climate is a long-term phenomena and central banks should be focusing on the short term. But where that's wrong is climate is already affecting real estate, and there is real, what we call transition risk, the risk that prices will adjust, that they haven't fully taken, the market hasn't fully taken on board the carbon risk, and if the carbon prices adjust, there will be big adjustment of asset values. And we know what happened in 2008 when the price of real estate adjusted. It was a global financial crisis. And the importance of carbon assets is much greater than America's subprime housing market. So that if there were an adjustment of asset prices to reflect a recognition of carbon risk, it could be very disturbing to financial markets. And the U.S. does not assess this. Going forward, if there were another Biden administration, it's likely that there were new head of the Federal Reserve would recognize carbon risk. But with Trump, that won't happen. So these are examples of regulatory changes that will be very big in the difference between Trump and Biden. Another area where there'll be a very big difference echoes what was said a little bit earlier. Climate change is a global issue, and Trump doesn't believe in multilateralism, and Biden does. And so the difficulty of getting a global agreement is going to be just much greater. If you remember, Trump withdrew from the Paris Agreement, and Biden will try to revive it. To give you just one more example, Trump appointed to be president of the World Bank. Traditionally, the president of the World Bank is appointed by the U.S. Doesn't have to be. It's not in the structure, but it's been that way. Trump appointed David Malpass, who did not believe in multilateralism and did not believe in climate change. And that meant the World Bank, the most important institutions for pushing climate in developing countries and emerging markets, was not active. And now Biden has appointed somebody who is much more committed to climate. So those are some of the ways in which there would be a very big difference between Biden and Trump on energy policy and on climate policy. Let me talk about some of the ways that they will still be similarities, so that there were, you know, it's not going to be a 180-degree shift. The attitudes, the mentality couldn't be greater, but you don't change the direction of U.S. policy overnight. So the shift in actual policy will be a little bit smaller. And let me try to illustrate the areas in which there is going to be commonality. One of the distinctive differences between the U.S. and the EU is that America now is energy independent. In fact, the United States has become a major exporter of energy, particularly oil and gas. We've surpassed any of the other countries in the world. So we've become we have this kind of energy security that is very different from the dependence that Europe has. And that's likely to continue. But the direction is going to be very different. Biden is going to try to restrict the leasing of public lands where there are environmental risks. There's going to be a restriction on pipelines. So it's going to be a real focus on trying to expand the renewable energy market as opposed to expanding the fossil fuel market. So under Trump, you will see a very big expansion of fossil fuels. And under Biden, that will be very limited, but you'll see more of an expansion in renewables. The second aspect that will continue is, which is a little bit aggravating from the point of view of Europe, is the massive subsidies that the US is giving for green technologies, the IRA. It's called the Inflation Reduction Act. Doesn't have anything to do with inflation, really, but it is a subsidies for American companies to move green. It was done in some ways with important good intentions of moving the U.S., joining the U.S. in moving in the green transition. But it violates WTO international trade law. And there was very little concern in the U.S. about the fact that it was violating international trade law. The magnitude of it is probably much larger than was advertised. It was advertised as being like $300 and some billion, which is big, but Goldman Sachs estimates it to be over $1 trillion. And Brookings Studies also estimates that it's going to be well over $1 trillion. And you know, I don't know how you feel about money, but $1 trillion is still a lot of money. And now that's, in many ways, has a positive thing for the world. They won't say it publicly, but one of the things that the Biden administration wanted to do was to Trump-proof the actions they were taking. What do I mean by that? They wanted to make sure that they would not be reversed if Trump got elected. And the way they've done it is to make them so generous that they've created a special interest to maintain these subsidies. So the companies that are receiving the subsidies will be a strong force to keep the subsidies. And particularly, the subsidies are going disproportionately to Republican states. So it will be very hard for the Republican congressmen and senators to vote to repeal the subsidies. Even though they don't believe in climate change, they also believe in special interest. And so they've now created a special interest to get the subsidies. So I think the IRA will continue, and that's for climate very good, but not for European competition and global competition. A third aspect as one thinks about U.S. energy and climate policy, is to recognize that it is embedded in discussions of geopolitics. And the dominant discussion in the United States right now is China. And I think it's very difficult for Europeans to fully understand the paranoia that the U.S. feels about China. Now, I think there are good reasons about the shift towards authoritarianism in China. There has been a very big, those of us who were very engaged with China for a long time have really felt a very big change in what is going on in China. So I don't want to minimize that change, but at the same time, China hasn't yet done anything that would, from a military point of view, of the order of magnitude that would have generated that paranoia, but it's there. And it's bipartisan. And so it is a very big part of US thinking, and because it's both parties, and it's focused a lot on economics, on economic competition, on the fact that China has grown in 40 years from a country where per capita income was $150 to a country which is now in aggregate income, in the way the economists usually measure it, which is PPP, purchasing power parity, larger than the United States. That happened in 2015. And the United States doesn't like being number two. So, and we haven't advertised it a lot. But it is part of the psychology of what is going on. Where does this show up? Well, it shows up in the conflict between greening our economy and our, you might say, employment policy, our economic policy. So for instance, where this is really important is the cheapest solar panels by far are from China. If we wanted to maximize the greening of the US economy, we would welcome in the solar panels. We might complain a little bit about that they're being subsidized, but if China wants to help us become greener by giving subsidies to America to have solar farms that are much cheaper by 30-40%, that's a huge subsidy to our energy industry. Why shouldn't we just accept their subsidy and to make our energy less expensive and renewable? So if green were the dominant part of our mind, we would be welcoming these subsidies. But we have imposed very high tariffs. It goes back way back to Obama, but they've continued under Trump. We've put increasingly high tariffs on solar panels and now on EVs and on batteries. And we're saying more important than getting cheap green products to our citizens and greening our economy is making sure that we have the capacity to produce it and we have a level playing field in production. And so we're sacrificing the pace of greening for our geopolitical economic strategy. I don't think we've gotten the balance right. I think it's important that we have the capacity to produce and compete on these new technologies, but I think that the importance of the green transition is, and doing it fast, I would have put accepted the subsidies and had other ways of trying to proceed in developing our capacities for producing EVs and solar panels and batteries. A couple of the reasons why I think the US, even with Trump, is not going to walk away from a green policy as much as we might have thought, is we have the stakes in the United States have a very big role in regulation. And the most important state in the United States is California. And California is very progressive and very concerned about climate. And so the standards that are set in California for cars become the national standards. And so the car standards, for instance, automobile standards, are going to be set by California. They're going to be moving very much towards green. And that will be where we will be. The other important player are multinational companies. Multinational companies don't want to say, we're going to produce green products for Europe and dirty products for America. That it's too hard to produce that kind of mentality. We'll be green where we have to be, but dirty where otherwise. It's just, companies don't like to think of themselves that nefarious. So I think that, and this is where I think Europe is really important, Europe, by having higher standards, is going to have sometimes called the Brussels effect, will spread, will mean that what happens in the United States will be better than it otherwise would have been. So both the multinationals and the states will play an important role. The final thing that I think is going to stabilize will prevent us from getting going out the way that Trump would have liked is a judiciary. And our judiciary at the top is not very good in terms of climate change, but it's a very diverse judiciary and moves very slowly in general. And there are a lot of suits going on that will, both in state courts and national courts, on climate. Just to mention one that I've been involved in is there's a group of 21 children that have been suing, very much like some of the children suits in Europe, saying that the governments are violating their basic rights by not undertaking enough climate. And the judge in Oregon, who will be hearing the case if it gets there, is very friendly towards the children. So it means that there is likely to be and there was already a case in Montana in a state court where they ruled that that the state was not protective enough of the children in terms of climate policy. So there's a judicial movement to try to constrain the government to be more climate friendly. The final thing that I want to mention, and I see my time is going up, the final thing I want to mention is global warming is a global issue. Climate change is a global issue. And the policies that both Europe and the United States undertake have to really take that into account. That even if the United States and Europe do carbon neutral by 2050, they do everything right, if they don't get the emerging markets and developing countries on board, we're doomed. Most of the emissions are now coming from the developing countries and emerging markets. And if we engage in policies which are viewed as unfair, which viewed as it will make it more difficult for them to get on board. And examples of those policies are the US IRA, which is subsidized. You know, we told countries for 30 years that they were not allowed to have industrial policies. And then the United States breaks those rules overnight and says, we don't care about the WTO. That's caused a little bit of anger in a lot of countries. And there's a hypocrisy. You only obey the rules when it's convenient for you. The second example is Europe's regulations about the importing products from newly deforested lands and some of the cross-border adjustments are viewed by the developing countries like a new form of green tariffs. And their reaction was, you know, you don't consult us on this. We didn't work out the details together, and it will disadvantage us. What I worry about is that this is creating a mood not for multilateralism and solving the problem together. I actually think, you know, the overall framework of the policies is right, but the process by which they were done was not one that was inclusive, and therefore risks a reaction that will not be helpful in solving what is clearly a global problem.
Thank you very much, Professor Stiglitz. That was quite an overview of the US perspective, federal, state, judiciary, and interesting to see that some of the things set in motion by the Biden administration are likely to stay with Trump, which is a bit unexpected, at least from myself. Next, we turn to Mr. Durão Barroso. Thank you very much for the European perspective.
Thank you very much, Jordi. Thank you. It's indeed a pleasure to be here in Madrid in this day, an anniversary of the rule of King Philip VI, 10th anniversary, and to be here at IESE, responding to a kind invitation from Naturgy, Naturgy Foundation. And to do it, sharing the panel with a great thinker like Joseph Stiglitz. So it's indeed a pleasure to be here with you. So the European Union policy, I thought you have, I'm sure you have in the audience real experts on energy, so I'm not going to teach you anything. What I can bring to the conversation is some of my experience in political and policy making on this matter. Because in fact, it was my commission, 2007, 2008, that launched what was by far the most ambitious climate action program at that time. And that gave us in Europe a title that we are usually very proud, is that we have been leading the world on climate action. Are we really doing it? That's a question. Are we really leading the world on this matter? That's a point I'd like to answer, to try to answer. And so it's important to put these things in perspective, what European is doing also in a comparative way, and what we can do in the future. Some dates, because this as a context, as a history. We can say the global community gave some attention to the issue of climate starting in 1992 with UNFCCC, so the United Nations Framework from Climate, Climate Conference. And then Kyoto in 97. Kyoto in 97, the protocol, Kyoto Protocol, that entered into force in 2005, that the European Union ratified in 2002, but that the United States have not yet ratified. So this is the first point. To be very honest, the problem is not Trump. The United States, until now, have not ratified any international significant instrument to fight climate change. And I don't think they will in the foreseeable future. With or without a Democrat or Republican in the presidency. By the way, the Chinese also will not do it. Because of their concept of sovereignty, these countries and some others, we could add India, they will not do what we Europeans have done, is to accept putting binding instruments, internationally and nationally, legal obligations on the fight against climate change. This is the most important difference we have. The Kyoto Protocol, in fact, there was a vote in the Senate, 95 votes against zero. 95 votes in the Senate voted against the Kyoto Protocol. So President Clinton, accepted the Kyoto Protocol. But the US have not ratified the Kyoto Protocol. And that was probably the founding, let's say, global instrument to fight the climate change. Then we had in European Union, coming more concretely to the European Union, it was in 2007 that at the European Commission we proposed the so-called EU 2020 package that some of you may remember. It was a reduction of greenhouse gas emissions by 20% compared to 1990. So the goal was to reach that reduction of 20% reduction of emissions by 2020. 20% gains in energy efficiency and 20% at least of renewables in the overall energy mix. So that's why it was called 2020. It was very difficult to make it approved at that time. We had already made a big enlargement of the European Union in 2004, but it was finally approved and approved finally by the 28 later, because at that time we were in the process of enlarging from 25 in 2004 to 28, when we had Romania, Bulgaria, and later Croatia members. And UK at that time was still. By the way, the UK was decisive to adopt the climate change package at European Union level. That's important to understand why. To be very frank with you, and I'm no longer in politics, so that's why I can say my sincerity is growing day by day. I'm telling you exactly what I think, and I'm not representing any institution. The problem is that most countries in Europe at that time did not want that package to come. They were not, I mean, the issue of climate change in 2007, it was not the priority in many of our countries. The new member states, they were not really in favor of it, including on the Western part. Those who were really committed were basically the UK and the Nordics, Scandinavians. Germany and France were somehow ambivalent. Spain and Portugal also a little bit. But to be honest, Spain and Portugal were among the most active on the issue of renewables. And in fact, Spain today is one of the leaders, if not the leader, on these renewables, namely when it comes to electricity. And Iberia, we can say as a whole, is in fact leading on that matter. So, but how was it possible to have 25 or 27 and after 28 countries adopting something that in fact they were have so different positions about? As it often happens in the European Union, when we have a problem, the best way to solve it is to enlarge it. Because when you enlarge a problem, you create, first of all, more people interested in its resolution, and there are more trade-offs between different areas. And the European Union is about a permanent negotiation, where we are in constant trade-offs. So a country accepts this reluctantly, because the country knows that they want something on another file. And here, that's why it was known as the Climate Change and Energy Package. Because what we're doing to convince our friend from Poland, for instance, and the Baltics, was say, look, we are going to finance increased measures of energy security, because already at that time of Russia, LNG platforms, reverse flows, and financing for this building of energy resilience. If not, it will not be possible. So that was in 2008, we have approved, the European Union, so as you know, European Commission makes a proposal, 2007, 2008 it was approved by the Council and by the Parliament. And in fact, we delivered, our goal was 20%, by 2020, the reduction of emissions was 31%. Not 20, 31%. Of course, there was COVID that year, but in 2019, it was 24%. So not only we have put some objectives, but we were going ahead above those objectives. So the European Union is basically delivering on its commitments on fighting climate change. Not other countries cannot do the same, cannot say the same. This was 2008. Then we had Copenhagen in 2009. You remember the Conference of Copenhagen, this climate summit. And then I have a story to tell you because it's important. At that time, we were full of enthusiasm. We wanted to have the countries of the world coming together. And of course, we were dealing namely with our American friends, and at that time it was President Obama. But in fact, what happened was President Obama came to us, to our room, where it was the commission, it was together with member states leading. So it was myself, it was Angela Merkel, it was Sarkozy, it was Gordon Brown, it was rotating presidency of the European Union. At that time, it was Prime Minister Reinfeldt from Sweden, and Prime Minister Zapatero was also at least part of the time in that room. And President Obama came and said, "Guys, you are doing a great work. Congratulations, but we cannot go with you. It's too ambitious. If you go that way, there will be no agreement. That's why I'm going to try to have some kind of agreement with the BRICS." And the conclusion of the Copenhagen Conference was, in fact, not a formal adoption. It's called sometimes the Copenhagen Accord, but it's a disagreement. But it was drafted by the United States with China, India, Brazil, and South Africa. And basically, it's much less ambitious. And in fact, the conference did not adopt it, but took note of it. And that was the agreement. It was basically a failure. Copenhagen was presented, by the way, at that time, if you remember, 2009, as a failure of the global efforts. And the European Union was very disappointed. We considered that we, because it's nice to say that we lead, but when we lead something, it's not very nice. If you lead something, you look around and there is nobody following us. To lead, we need others to follow. And that's unfortunately not the case, I'm afraid to say, in climate change in many areas. So from 2009, and I'm of course making many, just the most important points, we came to Paris in 2015. 2015, yes, there was an agreement, the Paris Climate Agreement. But it was the last time of the Obama administration. At that time, President Obama was ready to accept it. Let's be honest, because he knew he did not have to worry with ratification. That's the point. And what happened afterwards? The new American president, sometime later, the United States were the only country in the world that left the climate agreement. I mean, North Korea is there, Russia is there, China is there, but also Venezuela is there, Iran is there, but United States out. It's a little bit difficult. When the most important power in the world, because the United States is the most important influential country in the world, is not part of a global effort for fighting climate change. That's what happened with President Trump. So it's not easy, as you can imagine, to have a global solution without the most important stakeholder and one of the two biggest polluters, because China and the United States are the two most important emitters of greenhouse gas. Europe, around 7% now, and decreasing. Our share of emissions is around 7%, and so it was not easy. Anyhow, afterwards, what has the European Union do? The European Union is reinforcing its effort. In 2019, Europe declared to be climate neutral by 2050. But not only declare, it's in our legislation. And in 2020, we decided, going up, to have at least 50%, 55% fewer emissions by 2030. 55% compared to the original 1990. So we started with 20% reduction, now we are at 55% reduction, but with goals and targets in binding legislation. And in fact, also with some support to that. According to the Green Deal, according to all the instruments at European level, 30% of all European expenditure until 2027 have to go to climate-related projects. So there are subsidies in the European Union. It's not only the United States who make subsidies. There are a lot of subsidies now, including to renewables, and Spain, by the way, is doing a lot on that matter. But what is the difference? And then we come now to 2022. IRA, as Professor Stiglitz says, it has nothing to do with inflation, but it's basically a protectionist measure to to relocation of investment in the United States. But it was relatively well received by the European Union. Why? Because, in fact, it is the first time that the United States commit to something that is meaningful to fight climate. So overall, it was very well received, which is interesting. Even if it was quite clear from the beginning, this is going to make, because you are giving credit, taxes, credits of hundreds of millions of dollars. And I know what I'm telling, I'm telling you, I know many cases in Europe, investments that are planned to come to Europe, and now they are going to the United States, because the United States can offer these subsidies of hundreds of millions of US dollars that, according to our state aid rules, we cannot give in Europe. Even the countries that can do it, because Germany could do it in principle, but because of state aid rules, Germany cannot do it. So we are watching now, in fact, a very important, let's say, effect of relocation, of change of investment, as it was already mentioned by Professor Stiglitz, that I have no doubts that a new American administration would certainly willing to keep it. By the way, it's completely against the rules of WTO, because there is a condition, it is of local, the so-called local clause, it has to be done in the US. While in Europe we have subsidies, but it is not necessarily to be done in Europe. So, by the way, China put is suing the United States in the WTO. Of course, it will not work, because, as you know, the WTO is not the so-called appellate body. It's blocked already, and it was already by the Obama administration, now the Biden administration, and it will certainly not work. By the way, I'm sure if President Trump is elected, and at least 50-50 percent of possibilities, we believe, the probabilities of having a trade war globally are extremely high. And not only with China, also with Europe. So this is why we are, in fact, we have a problem in terms of multilateralism, because as it was mentioned, climate change is for the planet. We cannot say that only part of the world is going to be polluted. I mean, pollution does not need a visa to travel. So we need to have, we should have a global agreement. But I'm very pessimistic about the possibility of having a global agreement on climate change that are real, that people will implement. Because there was in Paris, and for instance, Chinese, they are committed, but they are committing best efforts. Their goal is to have to peak their carbon emissions by 2030. But they say, strive to peak its carbon emissions, and to, as an aspirational goal, to achieve carbon neutrality by 2060. So 10 years after the European Union. Of course, in that moment, they will decide if they will do it or not. Looking at what European Unions and others will have done by then, and of course, but without any legal binding commitment on their side. This is why I'm extremely concerned also with what's going to happen now in Europe. We are already, let's be honest about this, we are already seeing some backlash against the climate agenda in Europe. What happened recently with the demonstrations of the farmers in Brussels or in Paris, the reality is that the European Commission is already watering down some of its efforts after the commissioner responsible for climate action left and went back to his country, the Netherlands. The Netherlands, where, by the way, the party who won the national elections is against climate action, besides being a xenophobic, far-right, extremist party. And we have to think about this. We have to speak about the Netherlands, one of the more liberal countries in Europe history, that the first party is a far-right, xenophobic party, extremely critical of the climate agenda. Mm-hmm. And we have seen also what happened now in European elections. People don't think about it. But the party who lost more seats by far is the Greens. The Greens. People were looking about the far-right coming up. In fact, the far-right did not go so far as they were expecting, but the Greens lost a lot. And so we are seeing already some kind of backlash in Britain. not in the European Union, but Britain is already postponing some of their measures of climate transition. Because climate transition has a cost. All these measures, in terms of support to the sectors affected, they have a cost. And the fiscal pressure in our countries now is huge because of high levels of public debt, but also with the support to Ukraine, the support to refugees, the support, I mean, the overall support to our economy. It was, by the way, decided at European level with Next Generation EU and basically a good program. All these has a cost. So while I think in Europe there remains an overall strong support to the climate action, namely on young people, because there is a difference in generations, there is a strong support, but when people ask, if you ask people, are you ready to have less of your revenue and to finance more climate action, then there you don't see, of course, the same level of support. So I'm afraid that we are going to see some backlash against the climate action at European level, not because there is less awareness, on the contrary, about the dangers of climate change and the existential need of doing something to save our planet, but also because there are so many contradictory pressures, namely from a fiscal point of view, on our governments and with a huge levels of public debt. And we have some fiscal rules at European Union level that limit what we can spend. So I believe we are in a difficult moment. I believe there is already going on at European Union level some kind of recalibration of the objectives. One thing I've learned in Brussels is the following. It's very difficult at European level to take decisions, but it's even more difficult to change them once they are taken. Because there is in the system some kind of rigidity, you understand? And some of these measures require unanimity at political level. And once they are taken, afterwards, those who are more in favor of them, they don't want to hear about any kind of revision. So most likely there will not be a change in European Union legislation, but there will be, and the creativity of the European lawyers is boundless, there will be ways of postponing, of mitigating, of exceptions, and so on. But the ambition is not going to be the same. Of course, the problems are also because it has to do with European Union, United States relationship. When President Biden announced his IRA, many people were expecting Europe to react very strongly. On the contrary, because of the very good climate, today we have a very, I think from my, as far as I remember, and I can remember until the 80s, when I was in official position in my government, my country, this is the best moment of a transatlantic relationship between the American administration and, let's say, Brussels. There is a direct line, very good relationship, not only with Brussels, but also with Berlin and Paris and other capitals. And completely different from Trump. President Biden is someone who believes the US needs allies. So, for an American president, of course, America has to come first. For all of us, our country has to come first, but not alone. That's the biggest difference. With Trump, it will not be America first only. It will be America alone. And that is extremely worrying for all those who want to have a kind of a multilateral approach. Now, what happened was that European Union, instead of going against the United States in the WTO, there were some negotiations in something that was created. It's a kind of a council on economy and technology that exists between the US and the European Union. And the Americans promised to work with us in matters of the so-called Critical Materials Act, and we are working together, also because of China. China being, of course, the most important issue in the United States, as was, and a matter, one of the very few matters, if I may say so, where Democrats and Republicans agree, is to be very tough on China. That will continue. But the problem is that when it comes to trade, we don't have an agreement with the United States. And this is extremely important because part of our European agenda on climate change, to be feasible and to be supported, needs to have, at European level, the CBAM, so the Carbon Border Adjustment Mechanism. The United States, are they going to accept it? I mean, with Trump, it's out of question. But with, even with Biden, I have many doubts. Some days ago, I was asking a very important member of this administration, what is going to be your position? And they said, we have not yet defined. We are looking at some ways of... Because the problem for a climate transition point of view for Europe is its acceptability from a social and from a competitiveness point of view. From a social point of view, it's a very serious problem. For instance, the previous government in Portugal announced a measure that afterwards they had to withdraw was 10% more of taxes on cars that were older than 20 years. Of course, it's a complete mistake from a political point of view, because there was an upheaval immediately. They had to, I mean, you are putting more pressure on the people that have less money, socially completely unfair, and by the way, not very helpful. And this is the issue. We have to have a success on our climate change agenda, we have to be attentive to the social impact of the measures and to the competitiveness impact of the measures. Because I don't see the European industry accepting that they are going to continue with the highest standards, but afterwards they can import anything from the US or from China or from India without the same. That's why there is a CBAM. Its implementation started already in a provisional manner. But when it's going to be into force, are the Americans and the Chinese and the Indians and the others accepted? I bet they will not. So ideally, the only way to do it, from my point of view, was, by the, has been suggested by some think tanks and some intellect, some experts, to have a kind of a club of the countries that are more committed. Ideally, it should be the European Union with the United States, probably Canada, even if Canada, in climate, it was one of the first countries to say that they will not go to implement the second phase of Kyoto, Canada, Japan, and Russia. But nevertheless, if you could have European Union, United States, Canada, and UK, of course, but also maybe Australia, Japan, and others, then we'll have some critical mass among ourselves to do it. If not, I can tell you, there will be a big backlash against some of the climate action measures at European level, probably in the next 5 years. I think I already gave some ideas to discuss.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Barroso. This was an exciting presentation, and we have, probably 50 questions. The next time I do this, I would like to have a desk here. A proper desk that I can organize,
desk.
Spread them around. So what I've done is I've collected, I've grouped some of them, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 questions, all right? And some of the questions, I have to discard them, otherwise it would be impossible. I've tried to organize them by theme. The first one actually ties well with your last remark. I think that the issue of the transition is generating a huge political backlash, particularly in the European Union, essentially for two fundamental reasons, which have been summarized in your answers, but the audience is keen to hear more about it. One is the effect on the competitiveness of, in this particular case, the European industry, right? I mean, the fact that in Europe, we are introducing obstacles to nuclear energy, right? Or that we don't accept fracking, which is accepted in the US. So the competitiveness issue creates a backlash, and also the distributional issue. The fact, as you rightly mentioned, that everybody is very green, except when it comes to your pocket money and you have to pay higher. So what are your ideas as to what extent we can make compatible the transition with the competitiveness and the distributional effects? Otherwise, we run the risk, some people argue in the questions, we run the risk of having more negative, people like Trump that have a narrative that says there is no climate change, basically because they don't want to accept the difficulties of climate change policy.
A view a little bit about a counter view on the standard narrative. I actually think that moving forward in a rapid moving forward in climate change, if you do it the right way, is good for competitiveness and good for economic growth. And one way of thinking about that is just think what we've done in the last 10 years, lowering the cost of renewable energy by about 90%. And what's happened here in Spain and Portugal, a lot of innovation in this area. We were really down the learning curve in fossil fuel, and we have just an enormous potential for restructuring production as we think about the green transition. So my view is that the green transition can be a very big stimulus for competitiveness and for growth. The issue of distribution is critical. But again, if we do it right, we can, one of the problems in France was that a lot of the yellow vest people were in areas where they had to use cars. They were poor, so they were inefficient cars, but they had, a few years later, taken away the public transportation system. So if you use public transport, build up a good system of public transportation, you actually reduce emissions and reduce their cost of living. And so I think that there are strategies of combining competitiveness and distribution with a green transition. One has to be very conscious about it, and I think Macron was not that conscious about it when he lowered taxes on the very wealthy right before he raised the taxes on energy, on the carbon tax. That was politically a very bad way of framing what was going on. So I think it can be done. It's not going to be easy, but it's important for us to begin to say that to recognize that it's not just a cost. One way, and let me put it one more way, if we don't deal with climate change, we're going to deal with the cost, the wildfires, the heat waves that are not, the floods, the extreme weather events. We are going to have to pay for those so that they are going to be impinging on our standards of living in one way or another. And the right counterfactual has to take into account the cost that we will pay if we don't do a more rapid green transition. So again, we need to make that very clear. In some ways, nature is helping us because it's been so bad for us in the last couple of years. So it's made it clearer in my mind that if we don't do something about this, we'll be paying a very, very high price.
Okay. No, first of all, that has been our argument. That's, of course, when we launched when we in the European Union launched and it was, I'm proud to say, my commission who launched the biggest effort, that is exactly the point, not only to protect the planet, but for our modernization of our economy, for becoming more competitive, green growth. This is the point. Including, by the way, and energy security, being less dependent on fossil fuels because Europe is a net importer of fossil fuels, yeah, differently from the United States. And at that time, our dependence on Russia was huge. Today, it's not so relevant. It's almost irrelevant, to be honest. And that was, by the way, amazing, how the European was able to adapt in such a short period, namely what Germany has done. So this is our argument. Our argument for the climate, the Green Deal at European level is exactly this one. But the climate change is a global problem. We cannot have Europe without climate change, without global warming, without floods, without forest fires, and the rest of the world burning, no. So if you think, I mean, just if you are in the room and we are three of us or four of us smoking, and one says, I will never smoke, but if the three others continue to smoke, I mean, it does not make a difference in terms of how polluted the room will be. That's an image, and that's what Europe is doing, is that we're no longer going to smoke, great, but we are going to continue the smoke of others, which is not very pleasant if you are making an effort to give up smoking. So this is a problem, in fact, because in some industries, they are very exposed to international competition, as you very well know. Namely, I mean, carbon-intensive industry. By the way, the United States keeps a tariff on steel from Europe. It was created by Trump, but they are still there. And so on these sectors, the only way for Europe to keep some kind of industry is to have a carbon border adjustment mechanism. If not, the industries are going to close, as simple as that. And now I'm extremely worried from a political point of view, because that's one of the arguments that the far right is using. And in fact, they are having some success, this argument. There is a kind of a deindustrialization. I mean, the same argument that Trump has used in the Midwest, in the United States. So there is a, it's going, everything is going to China. No, that's the argument he was using. And by the way, China has been a net beneficiary of the climate change policies. Because if there is a country that has been gaining in all industries climate-related, green, not only the solar panels, but also the windmills, and most recently electric vehicles, that, by the way, the United States, with Biden, not with Trump, already announced, I think, 100% of tariffs, and Trump promised the double. And now Europe, of course, Europe has to do something, because if the electric vehicles go to the United States, they pay 100% or 200% of tariffs, they will come here and they will completely destroy European, one of the most important European industries, that is automobile industry. It's not because we are protectionist, but we have to do something on that matter. European Commission already announced that it's now reviewing and will certainly come with some, not so aggressive, but some tariffs on electric vehicles. Hmm? So this is a problem of global competition, whether we like it or not, that has a direct impact on jobs. We can say, well, we are going to create new jobs. Yes, it's true. And by the way, and to some extent, very successful. But there are other industries that are extremely exposed to this international competition, where Europe, if it does not act, not only will have an economic problem, but it will have a political problem that already is appearing in this, in the arguments against climate change. So we all are, I think we all, not all, unfortunately, there are still some climate denials and the climate skeptics. But basically, I think in Europe, most people want a strong action against climate change, against global warming. But the problem is how to do it in a way that is socially acceptable and also efficient from a point of view of global competition, where we have others to commit. And that's
Can I just make two comments? One, I think it is the other reason for the cross-border adjustment mechanism is it provides incentives in the U.S. to comply. So it's part of, I view this as part of a global political economy. It's not only protecting Europe, it's also incentivizing the United States. One of the things where, let me emphasize how big a break this is from traditional WTO policy, where traditionally you were not allowed to differentiate tariffs on the basis of how goods were produced. There was a very important case called the shrimp turtle case, where they, the WTO appellate board said, you can differentiate when there's an important environmental issue. So imposing a cross-border adjustment mechanism, if it's done in the right way, is consistent with international law and has that political economy advantage. The other thing that's going on right now is a discussion of small treaties as opposed to these comprehensive treaties. So how do we, you know, there's a breakdown of international trade law. It's very clear, and you described it. So the question is, how do we preserve some order in this world? Well, one argument is, let's have treaties that are not as ambitious as the old one, where you try to get everything in, but very narrow. So we'll have a steel treaty where we say steel has to be produced in a particular way, and if you produce it in that way, you know, low carbon, then there won't be any tariffs, and if you don't, there'll be adjustment. And there are these initiatives going on now on these more limited kinds of treaties that will allow for a rule of law within specific areas. And let me, these are areas that turn out to be very important, both in terms of competitiveness and in terms of green.
No, not only, you are completely right. That's what I meant with those clubs. So not only in terms of some products, but also in terms of some countries. If you could have a critical mass of countries supporting some kind of standards, that will, of course, will make it easier to go ahead with the climate, our climate agenda. If not, I continue to think a backlash is a possibility. Now, I just want to highlight a point I probably have said it earlier. About IRA, I think there is something that is very positive there at the same time, is that basically the United States are following a strategy of carrot, where Europeans are following a strategy of stick. I mean, simplifying. Europeans, they put some rules and they put a cost on carbon. That's the logic of the ETS system, so the emission trading scheme. Okay, so if you do more than, if you are producing more carbon than you should, you pay. Okay. The Americans have a completely different approach. It's no, if you do something on climate, against climate, we give you some support, namely through tax subsidies or tax, many ways of supporting, in fact, incentives. But one thing that I believe probably will help us find a solution for climate in the long term is the investment the United States is doing some areas on technology. Because from my point of view, and I've been, of course, speaking with experts, I'm not an expert on climate, energy, or energy, but I've been speaking with some of the best experts in the world, I have many doubts that with the current level of technology, we are going to achieve the goals of carbon neutrality by 2050. I'm extremely skeptical about it. And we see also the resistance there is in some quarters, not only to hydrogen, but also to carbon capture and storage, and now even to nuclear. By the way, nuclear is going to come back. Have you seen what's happening in Italy? Italy rejected already twice nuclear, and now the minister, the government of Italy, says they want to reconsider the reintroduction of nuclear. So, but there are other areas of possible developments and major technological breakthroughs that, for instance, some great universities in the US and institutes, they are developing, including and not only in the US, but the US is leading on that matter, nuclear fission, and also in terms of geoengineering, atmosphere engineering. Of course, the Greens, the typical Green politician does not like that. Huh? Anything that appears to be manipulating them, they are by definition against. But I personally believe that maybe the solution that will, to come to a solution on climate change globally, it will come from major technological disruptions, including some that are going to be fueled by artificial intelligence. Now, some of the best minds in our universities and in US are devoting a lot of time, energy, and with some financial support to this area. So this is the good point about, I think, the American policy, because on the other point, I'm afraid we are I mean, as Europeans, we cannot follow it. In Portugal, in a part of the country of where I come from, it's in Alentejo, where we have the porco ibérico, the pig. There is a saying, is the following. In principle, there is, and I think the same can be adapted to, of course, cum grano salis, to climate transition. In principle, there is no problem with the pig. In principle, there is no problem with the sausage. The problem is the transition. And that's the point. How much does it cost? And how are we going to finance it when others are not doing the same effort to come to the point?
Okay, I mean, in your conversation, some of the questions drop and I remove them because they become answers, so that's easy. My job is easier. However, on the transition, there's a couple of questions which I think are illustrative of how difficult it's going to be, and also a challenge for the speakers. And in the case of Professor Stiglitz, who mentioned that he was not quite sure that markets were solving things, the question is, what's happening in the European market in terms of the capacity of renewables, which has been installed, which is already way beyond the levels of consumption that are needed. It is unlikely that is going to be needed, and prices have dropped, and this makes less attractive the investment in this technology. And I tie this with another question, which mentions the fact that the market for electrical vehicles, which experienced a certain boom a while ago due to the subsidies, now is tapering off. So I think that the two questions point to this difficult issue of the transition. The market, it's unlikely to do a good transition. Regulation, is it likely to achieve such a transition? And at the same time, this ties with the question, with the last point that Mr. Durão Barroso mentioned. Should policy be more open to alternative technologies instead of betting the house on electrification? What do you think?
Well, I think, let me pick up on what was said before. I think clearly innovation is going to be critical in the green transition. Let me step back a second and point out that there's been a lot of focus on energy, and particularly obviously because where we are, but for the green transition, it involves all our systems. So it's the agricultural system, how we do agriculture, how we structure our cities, how we structure our housing, our buildings. So, you know, energy is a very important part of the answer, but for the green transition, we really have to take a much more holistic view of the transformation of our society. In terms of energy itself, there's a lot of exciting things going on, various kinds of work going on biomethane, we were talking about hydrogen. I mean, there were lots of different, and I think very innovative ideas going on both Europe and the United States. A lot of hard problems. You know, storage is the big issue, and how you do that effective buffering, not only within the day but with across seasons, is going to be a big deal, and across country regions in a country. So there are a huge number of problems, and each of them real opportunities for innovation to make differences. I think sometimes we think of innovation too much as a single breakthrough, whereas really most of the innovation is incremental. We make an improvement in one place, another place, and overall, within 10 years, we've made very big changes. So I think having this broad perspective that we have to reduce emissions in many, many areas, and we need concerted efforts in all these areas, including public investments, like I mentioned before, infrastructure, public transportation. You know, U.S. still doesn't have a train system that works. And as an example of something that could happen in the United States, not a big innovation, but it would be a transformative one in our transportation system. So there's always a very big lag between the best practices and what we've actually implemented. And if we just got up to the best practices, the level of emissions would come down enormously. So I guess the first thing that I want to focus on is the enormous number of dimensions in which we can both promote growth and get emissions down.
And first of all, innovation, we can, of course, agree 100%. And by the way, I have to say one thing. What the Chinese are doing also in terms of technology and innovation in this matter is huge and remarkable. I told you, I think I was in China recently, and I was invited by them to go to Sichuan, which is the province where they have the biggest cluster of green technologies. And I spoke extensively with experts. I also met the prime minister, the premier, the finance minister, different members of the government in Beijing later. But I spent 2 days speaking with experts in China that are really leading their agenda on climate. And it's amazing. They have it extremely well prepared. They have some of the best engineers in the world, by the way, many of them trained
in the US.
In US. Many of them trained. For instance, I remember a relatively young professor, a woman, her 40s, extremely bright. And I spoke with the number one on the climate transition on China. And I have no doubts that now they really embrace this agenda. They believe there is climate change, because at the beginning they were not completely, there were some skepticism. And they were saying that that's basically your responsibility because you have been polluting the world, you, the West, have been polluting the world since the Industrial Revolution, now you don't want us to grow. So that's why you, okay, and that they come with that concept of common but differentiated responsibilities and so on and so on. Now they've embraced, they are teaching their boys and girls at school that there is climate change and that we should protect our planet. So they are sincere about it. But what's happening? At the same time, they have now the number one industry in the green industry in the world, clearly ahead of ours and ahead of the American. If you look at solar panels and all the electric vehicles, much, much better than ours, sometimes with American technology. Many of the cars that we are importing in Europe, electric vehicles, the Teslas, are made in China, but they are there. So that's the beautiful thing about trade. The problem is that at the same time, they are continuing to build coal-powered plants. So what the Chinese are doing is doing both. They keep the fossil fuel industries. In fact, they are developing, they are investing. At the same time, they invest in renewables. Not only they are hedging, but in fact, they have the benefit of both worlds. You see what I mean? This is another interesting point is what happens with the Gulf countries. The Gulf countries are investing massively in green transition. Because they understood, of course, that the green technologies and forestry are, it's going to be the future. But at the same time, with reducing relatively the investment in terms of fossil fuels, it keeps, of course, the prices up. That's why gas and oil continue, for the foreseeable future, they will continue at a very high level, and the demand is going to continue. Because ideally, in an ideal world, we should now be reducing the demand on oil and gas, okay, and increasing the demand on other sources of energy, okay. But that's not what's happening. The demand on oil and gas continues to go up. By the way, the United States are in a very good position from that point of view, because now they are next net exporters of energy. And we are net importers of energy in Europe. And we don't have, the fracking and other possibilities that the United States have. This is why Europe is extremely vulnerable in this matter. And we have to find, to calibrate a policy that is able, of course, to deliver on the climate objectives, but at the same time not to destroy what we still have in terms of industry. And not to put and not to create a movement of the public opinion that until now has been basically in favor of the transition, strongly against it. And that's my concern, because I see now in some of our countries a real movement against the climate agenda. And the part of the growth of the far right has to do with this. Don't underestimate that.
Can I say one thing about more support for EVs one of the problems of the EVs has been that you can't refill the car if you're going, especially in the United States, going across the country. And one of the things that they've done in the IRA is pushed a whole system across the country of refill stations. So the point I'm trying to make here is that if you want something like an EV to be successful, you have to complement it with public investment and regulation and subsidies. So think about what are the barriers to people adopting it. In that case, the problem was you can't get refilled if you're going across the country. Now we've solved, we are in the process of solving that problem. And the broader issue is, I think the price of things like the EV will come down dramatically as the scale goes up. Tesla was very expensive in the beginning, and the new cars come, it's fallen, and I think with the new technology to fall a lot more. So if you combine that with regulation that helps the scale to go up, then I think these technologies will become more accessible.
Good. I have a couple of questions which tie well now with the discussion you've been having, and which are quite specific. And related. One of them says, when will the peak in the value of assets that produce fossil fuels, when will that arrive? Is it possible to have an idea? What should be the weight of the supply of fossil fuels in the total supply? And related to that, to what extent are we going to have Europe delaying the goals that it has now for 2030 and 2050 because of the backlash and both coming from the farmers and the competitiveness of industry? Is there going to be a delay? And will it affect, because of course, if there is a delay, it affects the price of the stranded assets of fossil fuels, which we thought that would become stranded, but so far they continue to have some value.
So I'll take an optimistic view, and probably maybe more optimistic, that, and it's based on a kind of pessimism. I think the events of climate change are going to continue. And very forceful, and the climate models have a lot of what we call non-linearities. Things really get worse much more rapidly. So we're having now in the United States unusually hot weather. A year ago a lot of people died in Vancouver, Canada, a place where they didn't used to have heat waves of that magnitude. So I think that the extreme events, the rising of the sea level, are going to, and youth movements that are very conscious of what it's doing to the future of their world, I think are going to increasingly provide evidence, even for the climate skeptics, that something needs to be done quickly. And this goes back to the beginning of my remarks. It really depends on whether Biden or Trump gets elected. If Biden gets reelected, the kinds of disclosure requirements that companies have to make about their climate risk are going to just increase. And that's going to make people think more and more about climate risk. And the more people have to think about climate risk, every time in every company report, they will talk, what will happen if? And that makes people think about it more. I can't give you a precise date when you should sell your...
I don't have any.
your carbon assets, but I think there is going to be a continual movement to divest of carbon assets, and it may not be a sharp break. I mean, the best would be just a gradual decline in fossil fuel assets, so it's not a dramatic moment, but a clearer and clearer picture that carbon assets are going down in value and renewable assets are going up in value. If we survive and we don't wind in a terrible trade war and all the disaster of multilateralism that could occur under a Trump, I think within the next 10 years we will see the beginning of the beginning of the end of the fossil fuel model.
Good.
I wish you're right. But I'm a little bit more skeptic, not about the need to do it. On the contrary, I'm really strongly in favor of a strong action on climate. That's why in Europe we, in fact, took the lead on these measures. But I'm more skeptical about it. And in fact, one thing is to invest in fossil fuels. Another thing is the price. Because part of the... if we invest less in fossil fuels, if we invest less in gas, most likely the price will go up. There will be less capacity, less supply. So that's what I meant about what some Gulf countries are doing. Some of the Gulf, for instance, the sovereign wealth funds of the Gulf countries, they are today probably the biggest investor in climate technologies and green technologies. They are the biggest investors. Because they, in that case, they win on both sides.
But if I...
They win because there is a so-called revenge of the old economy. That is the revenge of the old economy. When we have less production of gas or less supply of gas, of course, we need it, including for the climate transition, we need some gas, so the price goes up. That's what we have seen recently. The price of oil and gas has not been going down as will be desirable if you have already, let's say, credible and market alternatives. So why?
So there are two points, though. That we have enough oil for 2050, 2060, 2070, in terms of discovery.
Exactly.
Gas is a little bit different than oil because, especially the fracking, which has its own problem, the production technology is a 3-4 year period. So you're not committing yourself to a 25 or 35 or 40 year investment like you are when you're doing a deep water, off of Brazil. Those are long-term investments. So if you think of gas as a transition, you can do some of the fracking gas, bring it on, and its cost of production is relatively low, and that will keep the gas price from getting too high as long as there's a huge, I think, potential supply of fracking gas around the world. And the innovation in renewables has been so strong that I think that is really going to be driving.
So you think that the low price of renewables because of innovation will drive out gas from the market at some point?
Oh, they'll drive the oil out.
Oil and then gas.
And then gas. There's one piece in there which is the the buffering over the day and over the cycle. I'm optimistic that, you know, that's the hardest piece to solve. I think we will solve it in the next 10, 15 years. But even with that, the interesting thing is that we have so much of the old fossil fuel, gas and oil, that it can serve as the buffer at the marginal cost.
But so the producers need the incentive to have that supply ready. How are you going to solve that?
But, well,
I mean, if the price is too low, there will be no investment in that buffer.
No, I'm saying it's already existence. All we have to do is make sure that they get compensated for the marginal cost of sustaining it.
Okay.
So the real thing is we've made the big investments in the fossil fuels. We have a little bit of investment to keep these on as buffers. And that's part of the resilience cost that we have to pay. But with that, I think we can be mostly renewable.
I'm sure many people in the audience, because in the Spanish market, this issue has been one of the important ones. How do you pay for the buffer that you need? Even if the country produces lots of renewables, at some time of the day, you need the buffer, right? So now, let me move on, because there's still a few questions and interesting ones. One has to, you already discussed it a bit, but we know that as of today, 2024, in the Western economies, the governments have reached, I would say, the highest level of government debt relative to GDP compared to, I mean, since World War II, right? And the transition has to be funded. And you've been talking about subsidies. We know that during the Ukraine war, there were lots of support for families and companies. How do we square this? How are we going to get private investors devoting resources to the transition with regulatory uncertainty, without making sure that they are going to make a reasonable rate of return? And last but not least, since I'm familiar with the financial industry, there was a question here. What should be the relation between the financial and the energy markets, in your views? Also, you see, it's a whole package of funding.
So let me begin by saying, going back to the theme that this is a global problem. And so to me, one of the big pieces is finance in developing countries and emerging markets. And there...
There's a question there. Also, let me take the opportunity. There's a question, which I think is very important, right? I mean, the question talks about the historical debt, because these markets are polluting more than advanced economies, but they have not polluted that much in the past.
Yeah, so I'm in favor of two things that I hope will be on the agenda when you have your big development conference here in Spain a year from July. So one of them is special drawing rights, which are the kind of money that the IMF can create in a way which does not spur global inflation. It can do it at $200, $300, $400 billion a year. And that would provide a lot of resources for developing countries to make the green transition. I don't have time to explain how it works, but it's an important tool that's begun. The other one is the creation of a green development bank. The world is a lot bigger in GDP than it was in 1944 when the World Bank was created. And there are new missions, in particular climate change. And so I think there is scope for the creation of a green development bank that would help work with the private sector to develop the projects in developing countries and mitigate some of the risk. So to me, you know, looking at this as a global problem, I mean, I'll recognize that it is, these are the two most important ingredients and the hardest part, because the risk if you think about the returns, you know, with the lowering of the cost of renewable energy, a lot of, I think markets will be able in advanced countries really to deliver the more efficient technology. It's the risk premium in the South that is the major impediment that I see.
The European Union is the biggest provider of climate finance to the developing world, precisely because of the points you've mentioned. There is an historic, so in fact, an industrialization of Europe was responsible for a huge part of the emissions. And I believe the intention in the European Union is to continue to have a leadership role on that matter. In fact, it is doing through the European Investment Bank. The European Investment Bank is in fact the biggest multilateral bank in the world. And it's devoting a huge part. Now it's, by the way, the Spanish, Nadia Calviño is the new president. And I know, speaking with her and with the EIB, that they are really committed to continue to give a high priority to the green transition, but not only in Europe, but also financing and helping finance the developing world. But coming back to the point, if Trump wins, do you believe there will be a green bank? No, that's the point I wanted to highlight. I mean, because if we have a global problem, we need a global solution and we need a global participation. And the United States are the most important country in the world in terms of influence in the world. If you put together the economy, the finance, the technology, the defense, capability, so-called soft power, all this together, we need the United States. We need the United States to co-lead at least this effort. And I'm afraid we are not seeing that. And we also need China. China is already becoming the biggest emitter of greenhouse gas. And they are doing a lot, as I've mentioned, but at the same time, they are keeping also the other side of the, and they are not facilitating in global agreements when it comes to some forms of a level playing field. This is the point. But now, the point you also mentioned about debt, I mean, you have the experts, economic experts are here, I'm not, but I think, correct me if I'm wrong, I think we have never been at such a high level of public debt in the world as we are now, including the United States. I just saw now the figures of the US, and apparently what the federal government pays, the United States federal government pays in terms of interest of its debt, it's bigger than what they spend in defense. And defense being the number, the country that spends more in the world in defense is the United States by far. But so sooner or later, this issue of the extremely high levels of public debt that in Europe we are facing as well, I mean, including by a country like France, that has been recently downgraded by one of the major rating agencies, and with what I see about the programs for the new elections in France of the far right and the far left, that are not more fiscally responsible than the far right. I mean, it's a matter of concern. A matter of concern, how can we deal with all these levels of extremely high public debt, not only in Europe, where we try to have some rules that sometimes are not respected, as we know, but with US and others, including Japan and others. So it's a problem that we have, and that is one of, when it comes to a political decision, when a government has to come to a prime minister, government in Europe has to come with a political decision, they have to consider all these factors. How much are we going to invest here? How much are we going to invest? And my concern is that precisely because of all these pressures that I've been highlighting, including political ones, there will be less appetite, less enthusiasm to pursue the climate agenda as I would like it to be pursued. You see, this is the political problem I'm trying to signal. And we should be aware of the problems, not because to give up on our fight against climate change, no, but precisely to see what is the smartest way of doing it, in a way that we can keep our, let's say, support. We have great allies. First of all, biggest ally is science. We have big part of the public opinion that stays with us, namely the young people. So we have some allies, but we are also facing very strong headwinds against this agenda.
So let me take, you know, obviously I think you can't ignore debt, but I don't think, I'm not obsessed with debt. I don't think it's a big problem. And it would be less of a problem if we could get our central banks to lower their interest rates to more reasonable levels, and I've been campaigning.
Well, let's not go into interest rates, what? Because that's a whole debate, and we would bore the audience with a discussion for an hour.
But can I say on the interest rate, economists look at the issue from the point of view, what is the real interest rate? And the reason that interest rate, nominal interest rate is high is because there's been a higher inflation. In terms of the real interest rate, it's, you know, 1.5-2%, or even, you know, in some cases less than that. And so that's not that hard for us to afford. So my view is we can't ignore it, but on the other hand, we shouldn't get obsessed with it. But it is an argument for thinking about using regulatory mechanisms as well as subsidies. So saying there's a real penalty if you have emissions, using a carbon tax as giving a source of revenue. So rather than just the carrot, use a little bit more of the stick. And the combination of the carrot and stick gives you revenue that you can use then for the public investment for a green transition.
Good. We have time for one final question, but it will have to be somewhat short, the answers, and short the question. There's no meeting nowadays where you don't talk about artificial intelligence. So we have to talk about artificial intelligence. And the question is artificial intelligence net positive or net negative for climate? What do you think? I mean, in terms of the emissions of the electricity that you need to work the new algorithm, the language models.
I think it's net positive. I mean, it uses a lot of energy, obviously, but the ability to enable us to solve energy problems, to manage our energy system more efficiently, I think it's going to be enormous. And its ability to help us do research problems is going to be very large. You know, you can do experiments, mental experiments, faster than we've ever done. What would have taken hundreds of years, it can be done in an hour. So I think it's going to be one of, because the energy problems are very well-defined problems, I think it's one of the areas where artificial intelligence is likely to be really very fruitful.
Right. I mean, of course, immediately, as we know, there is energy, the artificial intelligence and the data centers that now are needed for that are very energy intensive. And in fact, part of the problem we are seeing now, once again geopolitically, is where are we going to build those data centers? For instance, I have not seen that in the media, but it was amazing what the United States obtained from the Emirates. Because now there is a kind of agreement to build some of those data centers in the Emirates with a guarantee, of course, of old energy for the data center, for AI. Because there is a global competition going on, mainly between the US and China. And this is a variable that I think we should also have present for everything. The global competition for between the United States and China is going to determine, to a large extent, what is going to be the future of all matters we have been discussing, including climate action, but also artificial intelligence. Because artificial intelligence is a dual-use technology that can have extremely good effects, namely on medicine. I've been, because of my role at Gavi, Global Alliance for Vaccines, I've been following what's going on in that landscape, and it's amazing. I mean, I mean, it's to use the word, a miracle. I wish I would be, I was born one or two generations later. For longer lives, for healthy lives, there will be huge developments in artificial intelligence that are extremely positive for mankind. But at the same time, artificial intelligence raises some ethical issues. Having said that, because you said net, you ask a very concrete question, net positive, net, I'm net positive, I'm in favor. I'm always optimistic about science and technology is part of the solution. And I believe, like Joseph Stiglitz said, AI can be part of the solution to help us find a response to the climate issue. And I know from some contacts with people that are on that sector, some of the leaders globally, by the way, most of them in the US, Europe is behind also on AI compared to the US. I know that they are working actively to provide some solutions for some problems that with our simple human intelligence, I'm afraid we cannot solve.
Okay, thank you very much to both of you. This has been a highly stimulating conversation. I have plenty of notes, also very, very good questions from the audience. I couldn't do justice to all of them. I was told that I had to close the event, but I have a watch here. I can see that it's only 3 minutes left, so I've timed it so that I don't have to really close the event. except for one remark that I want to make, which comes out of the discussion that we've had. We live in critical times. The election in the US in November is going to be a critical moment of humanity. Going forward, if you think historically, the situation at which we are, we have not discussed today the war in Ukraine, but it has implications for energy. If you think of the situation we are today, you can go back in history, and we've been discussing about increasing tariffs, subsidies, the breakdown of the WTO system. I mean, this reminds you of the Smoot-Hawley Tariff Act of 1930, which created a world of deglobalization and spread recession beyond the United States and the Great Depression all over the world. So we are at the moment where this trend of increased protectionism, nationalism, going for security and safety at home, protecting domestic workers, relinquishing the benefits of low prices coming from imported goods because they are subsidized. This goes in one direction, depending on what happens in November to a degree, because Mr. Trump is an isolationist and is not in favor of multilateralism. On the other hand, in your contributions, they made me thought about what we could say a Keynes moment, right? I mean, you mentioned the Green Development Bank, Professor Stiglitz. I mean, I remember Bretton Woods. After the Second World War, instead of going inwards, each nation trying to protect itself, we created a multilateral system which has brought humanity huge advantages, difficulties, but also huge progress. So I think that your contributions today have been helpful to all of us, shedding light on this historical moment, and the right tone of optimism and skepticism will be good for all of us for the rest of our working day and working week, and hopefully until the election in November. Thanks to very much to all of you, and hope to see you soon again in these Energy Prospective meetings of the Naturgy Foundation. Thank you.